A very good evening to you from wherever you're listening to 89.7 Contact FM. Our sincere apologies for starting late due to some unavoidable circumstances, but of course, better late than never. We're here, and of course, we're ready to put on the table some of the issues or stuff that has taken place throughout the last week that just ended, and any other development that may arise in the course of the program right here on the show. We get them on the table and talk about them right here. It's your number one opinion show. My name is Eugene Anangwe. I'm here with none other than Nash. Nash is here. How are you, Nash?
I'm fine. How are you?
I'm okay. Are you good? Okay?
Yeah, I am.
What about Matthew?
Terrific as always.
You're terrific.
Very well.
Okay, right. Nice to hear. Nice to hear. So we have lots of stuff to talk about today on the program, among them including the issue of drug trafficking. And of course, we'll also talk about other issues concerning corruption. And we'll also take a look at what some of my guests said on one-on-one last week. Among the issues we'll talk about is the concern of who is actually contributing to killing the music industry in the country. We'll be listening to some of the excerpts from my guest, that was Adams, that is DJ Adams. And of course, we also had a radio presenter on the program, that is MC Tino, who gave his views concerning the issue of some small monies being given to some radio presenters to promote what, according to DJ Adams, is mediocre music and musicians. So let's start off on a lighter note. I hosted someone here who many people believe is one of Rwanda's best top comedian, according to some of the people who have been hearing out there. And the guy is called Kanyombia. Kanyombia was on one-on-one. And I asked him a very simple question concerning the issue of the support that the creative industry is getting from the private sector. And Kanyombia was so sad. He was very sad at how the private sector is not contributing to supporting people like him and the industry itself. Let's start off by listening to what he said, and then maybe we can add in our input here and there.
Tangu zamani tumeanza tangu na tumewauliza nyinyi tunaandika barua vibarua vibarua hebu hawezi kupatia.
Kama wanakusikiliza saa hizi, if they're listening to you right now, what can you tell them?
Hebu unaweza waambia Wanyarwanda waweze watupatie nini? Kama wanatupenda kama sisi wasanii wasta wasaidie tufanye nini? Tupanishe nchi yetu mbele. Tupanishe nchi yetu juu kwa kuwa development ya Wanyarwanda kama wacheza filamu. Wafanya kazi wenyewe na ya arts. Watupandishe juu. Yani sisi tuko chini, tunaanza chini kusudi tupande juu. Kufika juu, hebu wao watupandishe tupande juu. Na tupanishe nchi yetu juu.
Yeah. So for those who don't understand what he's trying to say, it's pretty simple. He's calling on Rwandans to support the industry, the artists like him and others. And he's saying they've been writing so many letters to the private sector, some of the private sector members, to support them, but they're not even responding to their letters. So listening to what Kanyombia says, Matthew and Nash, what do you think, if you are from a private sector body that had money to support or to finance the creative industry, why would you not support them, or why would you support them? Give me two reasons. Let's start with you, Matthew. If you were to support them, what would you be looking for? And if you were not to support them, what is it that you would be checking and saying, no, this one I will not support?
Eugene, yeah, you are deliberately limiting my opinion on what Kanyombia said. You're making a deliberate move to choke some of my words so that they don't get out.
You can but feel free to ignore.
Exactly, because you're very far away from me. I'm very sure you won't get your hands on me, so I will make my opinion.
So the
first thing that I want to say is I don't think it's an issue of the private sector not supporting artists or comedians or the people in the entertainment industry. Rather, there are market forces in this country. To me, I think that people here have not yet come to realize the role that these communication and entertainment fields have to do within their businesses.
People who?
I'm talking about the private sector.
Yeah.
I'm talking about the entire country, in fact. You might look at the private sector alone, but even the public sector is not doing that much of financial supporting to these kinds of fields. So besides saying that, okay, you see, even when we write letters, no one responds to them, I won't look at it in that simple way. I think it's an issue of the market forces. The private sector here is still very small. You see, if you talk about the private sector, you if you asked him, he will tell you very few companies, MTN, Tigo. It's the same companies everybody will talk about. So the sector is still very small. And the people have not evolved to understand the value of these sectors. Because even if you looked at the institutions that we have here, the public education institutions, very little is given to the entertainment field. If you went to countries like, let's say, I'll not go very far, I'll go to neighboring countries, let's say Uganda, in the years back, you had, and even I think even today, Makere had programs like the music, dance, and drama. But you won't find them here in Rwanda. So the realm of the entertainment industry remains quite very small, and less emphasis has been put upon that. And the private sector in Rwanda, I would definitely give them some break. The sector is still very small. Like we always say, most of the business in this country is done by the public sector. We have a lot of public intervention in almost every sector. So if you want money in this country, every business looks at the public sector. So I won't say, because you see, Eugene, I'll give you an example. If I want to release a song, let's say I'm a musician, and I want to work on my product, have a very good album out there. The kind of man I need is not man I'll get from any small kind of company. I'll need big intervention. And those companies in this country are very few. So you, as Kanyombia, as another person, you will all target the same companies. You target MTN, you target Tigo, you target those telecoms, those banks, which are very few. So I think it's still an issue of the economic
dynamics.
Exactly.
So you've really talked a lot. So it means you've actually succeeded in evading the compression that I'd put. What about you, Nash? In your opinion, do you think Kanyombe and team and group are looking at the wrong places, or for support from the wrong places?
I'm actually shocked that he's the one saying that. I personally have a problem with his attitude.
Why? What do you mean?
Because 2 years ago, I actually called him to give him an opportunity of a lot of money.
Eh?
Yes.
And
I was
then
working for an agency. We were representing one of the big companies here. And they wanted him to appear on the billboards. And I called him. I looked for his number. It's not like I'd ever met him. But the attitude he gave me, maybe he should first start with changing his attitude. So I called him. He told me he's going to be at our offices at 10. 10 comes. I'm like, okay, well, even me, I have issues with time. So let me give him time. 10 minutes, 30, that's fine. I call him. I'm like, are you still coming? He's like, I have a show. When I'm done, I'm going to come. Midday, I call him. He's like, actually, this time he was very angry because I asked him, you see, you have things to do. We have things to do. I need you to tell me, I'm fine with waiting for the whole day and you appear at 6. But at least I need to know that when you say you're coming, you're coming, because I also need to deliver to the client. So what's going on? Oh my God. He unleashed for me insults.
I won't say hunger, I would say hunger. All the hunger.
I even thought maybe it's like, if you don't want to wait for me, who are you to even talk to me like that? I'll come when I come. I'm like, you know what? At that time, I was not the one supposed to make a decision, but I made a decision. I told him, don't. I'm calling you for an opportunity, the best you can do. And to be honest with you, I didn't shout at him because I didn't have reason to shout at him. I just asked him, can you please be specific and tell us what time you're coming, because you've been doing this since morning.
But still, maybe so, to do what I always do best.
The thing is, before you get, I know what you want to do. So the thing is, is that the reason why I should give up on him? Probably not. But you know what they say about first impressions? And this is not even an impression that you've given me when I've seen you and I've talked to you.
Yes.
This is on phone. I'm calling you for a business. It was worth 2.7 million. That's not very little money. And for only 1 year. And what was he supposed to do? Just stand there.
Just appearing on
and it. Just be photographed and he goes away.
Mm. But still,
so
yes,
hold on.
Yes, before I do what I do best.
If you ask me why would I have an opportunity right now? And I think of him. Because I'm thinking, if you have that attitude, before I work with you, what happens
when I work
when
with you?
We start and then I tell you the client hasn't liked how we took these
photos.
Maybe you need to
others.
Come back. Mm. You also need to be in a position to be able to work with people who are willing to work with you. Attitude. That's number one. Number two, maybe there's a problem of, as much as my colleague here, Matthew, is saying, what he's saying is true. He's saying there's a demand and supply. But I also think the clients, the people who are supposed to be giving them this money, are wondering, is this going to be worth our money?
You see, Eugene, before you cut in and do what you do best, like you said,
yeah.
What Nash is saying correlates what I said about the public institutions, the education system. Entertainment industry is not something very stressed here in this country. It's as if we are only catering about the straight army-like structures of the society.
Mm-hmm.
So when you look at the fact that even the people in the industry,
yes,
do not know how to market themselves, they don't go out there to try to look for these finances. You see,
before you even go to finding how to market themselves, maybe let's also look at, are they trying to look at the market and say, what I'm doing is actually matching the market that I'm dealing with.
Mm.
You cannot look at a comedian in Nigeria or in Uganda and you try to the same comedy here. Sometimes it doesn't work because this is a different kind of society. You cannot manage to make the British laugh and you think you're going to very easily make the Americans laugh. Sometimes it doesn't work like that. You need to know the kind of market you're dealing with.
But still, now you guys have talked a lot until
do
you
your job.
Confused me to
do your
what
job.
I need to do. I wanted to say, now back to Kanyombia as a character himself,
mm,
and the incident you had with him, Nash. If I become his advocate in this case and say he's just an actor, maybe that time the way you felt he was shouting at you, this is him. He's always in character.
So he's in character. Do I
even
have money to pay for character when I'm actually... This is serious business.
You
need to know how to separate serious work and...
And being a character.
And you do not start shouting at me and then give me the excuse of...
What I know...
I am in character. Really? You can do better than that, Eugene.
But you see, Eugene, let's be serious about this.
Mm.
He actually told me, if you don't want, leave it. I told him, actually, I'm leaving it. We got a local artist. We wanted to use him because, I mean, he's interesting to look at. You look at him and you smile. There's something about him, but it doesn't mean without him, the campaign cannot
move.
That's
exactly what I was going to say. Someone is just...
There's always someone to do the same job, maybe even better.
What I know for sure is, in many cases, what I see here is that most of our talents, of our artists, be it musicians or anything like that, there is a little stress or effort in putting up a marketing team or a team that goes ahead to manage them. Because in this case, I don't expect that you should talk directly to Kanyombia. In other words, if there was that seriousness with the little money that they make, they put up, they invest in a team that does communication for them, a team that does PR
marketing
for them,
yeah,
a team that does marketing for them. I think it would be better, because if you deal directly, you even risk having this kind of incident that you had over there. But all is not lost. I think we have artists, we have people in the creative industry that need support.
Eugene,
I think at that time, when I think about it now, at that time he was hot.
Mm-hmm.
So I think many people wanted...
He was a hot cake. He was on the market.
What people forget is that you're hot today and tomorrow you may not be hot. And you could be hot now, and for you to stay hot is for you to have discipline.
You have discipline.
You have to have discipline. You have to be dedicated. You have to know how to deal with people.
So could this be the reason why we are not seeing many people from the private sector supporting them?
Eugene,
I really cannot say exactly why, but I think it's also because they probably don't see why they should. Mm. You usually want to put your money in something that you know is
returns.
Going to, you are going to get
return,
return.
On investment.
So no. Why should I use Kanyombia? Maybe my product, I don't see how he relates to it.
Mm.
Maybe that's why I'm going to use an artist. Maybe that's why I'm going to use a radio presenter who mm. everyone listens to. Mm. There are things to consider. So I am not about to call him anytime soon. Unless
Eugene.
Yes.
You see, it is one thing to have talent. And it's a completely different thing to be able to use that talent to your benefit. You see, I might be able to look at Kanyombia, the way he appears, his looks, and I laugh. But is he in position to use his talent in the business realm, in a professional manner? So that is the question that goes back to the education system. You see, we have people who have talents. You have a talent in music, but then you need
someone to
harness that talent for it to be economically viable. There are very many people who have good football talents, but if you don't go through an academy and you get trained and you get taught how to use this talent in a better way, then you would just rot in the lot of very many people as anyone else does. So on the training part of it, the education part of it, I think we really need to have a section of the Rwandan education curriculum that caters for that kind of life, the entertaining world. Otherwise, we are running a society of only serious people who are just there looking at you like they are going to push a bullet through your head.
The good thing is that everything in Rwanda seems to be improving. 5 years ago, I don't think a comedian would have made it here. But now there's a show and the place is full to capacity. But like I said before, people need to know the kind of business they're doing and who to deal with and how to make sure that, you know, you create your own niche. There's your class, there's your category where people will be like, you know, we need this particular class of people and we are going to get this one, this one, this one, and Kanyombia. You need to get one thing, comedy, but what kind of comedy? Is it corporate? Is it everything? Then
you put it there.
You put it
what
there.
What I know for sure, whether you guys love him or hate him, whether you guys feel, whether you guys feel, I've said whether you like him or
hate
him.
I don't hate him. I was just.
I don't want you to.
Why would you hate a gentleman just trying to find his life around?
No. You're the one who's choosing the hating part. I've said whether you like him or hate him. Why don't you say I don't like him? Yeah, so whether you hate him or like him, the guy believes he has really contributed a lot. Whether even if it is, you know, in the industry.
I wanted to contribute more.
Whether it is creating job opportunities, this one just made my day that day. He says that he's happy that he has been able to help young people who are messed up and he's been able to support them through what he's doing. Let's listen to this one. How?
Sasa unaona kama mimi nimefaulu kwa nimetoa watu moja kwa wenye kuwa na idea mbaya njiani kama my bobos, mwizis, mbaragas, unacheka, iko mambo ajabu.
Naelewa.
Acha mambo kucheka, mambo kucheka hivi unacheka. Mbaraga, mbaragas, mwizis, my bobos. Hindi uza te na wengine wengine.
Umeondoa.
Ngoja subiri, maskinis. Maskinis. Na wengine wao wenye kupevuka wana.
Hawa walikuwa wanaenda kufanya mambo mabaya lakini kulingana na kazi yako wameondoka.
Ndio wanapata kazi.
Okay. Kulingana na wewe sasa hivi ni watu wangapi umeandika kazi?
Kazi? Wengi.
Kwa filmu yako?
Mbaragazi. Umekuja nimepata kazi wakapata pesa. Imbeciles na wamekuja nikawatosha kwa imbeciles wakakuja wakapata pesa na viurewerez wakakuja na vikuris, you know the vikuris.
There you go. So whether you like him or not, he's contributed. He has really helped these people that he has mentioned.
How?
The Mwizis
the Mbaragas and Vikuris.
Yeah, so he's supporting them.
You see, Gene,
yes,
I insist that yes, Kanyombia has a very good talent.
Yes,
and you see, let me tell you the truth. Very many people out there who are not in this country do watch Kanyombia.
They
were trying to connect.
No,
to the
but
country.
The thing is, no one has said he doesn't have talent. I'm just thinking about what Eugene said that he says no one wants to support them. Maybe there's something that he's not doing right. He's funny, but how is he selling himself? Is it, what is he doing about his talent? That's another
How
story
is he altogether. Using his yeah. talent? Which is what the education kind of system should be able to do.
Yeah. So when we return, we'll be looking at the issue of radio presenters and, of course, the issue of supporting and not supporting the entertainment industry, including the music industry, to be specific. DJ Adams was here and he opened fire. Let's listen to what he said.
All these presenters who are doing what is called showbiz, all of them.
All of them?
All of them.
Are taking the all viewers, the them, audiences yes. for a ride?
All of them, yes.
They're taking this small amounts of money to yes. promote this?
Yep.
Do you have any proof?
Unless if you want it in numbers.
Tell me. We have the time.
There are so many.
Tell me. Just 10 or even 5.
5 what?
Yes. Number one?
Presenters.
Yes. That you feel are taking people for a ride.
I told you, including your own on.
He was specific and he said it like it is. We'll be coming back. And of course, remember the lines are open. 897 is the number to call us in case you have any views that you want to share on some of the things that we're talking about right here on the program. This is Crossfire. Right, welcome back and thank you so much for choosing 89.7 Contact FM. The show you're listening to is Crossfire and of course the lines are open. 897 is the number to call in case you want to contribute or participate in the program. For those who are talking to us via Twitter, the hashtag is CrossfireCFM. Kindly add that hashtag on your comments so that we're able to trace them easily and of course we'll read them right here in the program. If you'd like to send us a message, write the word contact, leave a space, write your message and send it to the numbers 5000. And of course, it will be reaching us right here and we'll be able to read them right here. And on Facebook, it's Crossfire On Air. That's our official fan page. Okay, so before we went for the break, we had talked about the issue of those who are contributing to bringing down the entertainment industry, or specifically the music industry. Of course, later on we'll be looking at the issue of drug trafficking, but let's get on to this one. My friend Nash and Matthew, we have heard for several years now that there are some people who have been, saying that most of our presenters are actually receiving, not just presenters, even reporters. We've heard about reporters who are given the brown envelope to cover certain stories or to do certain stories. And that those who have been accusing or saying that that is really wrong. Now, we also have it happening in some radio stations, including here. We were accused that even here at Contact FM, we have radio presenters or shows where monies exchange hands for the interests of some musicians who, according to DJ Adams, are mediocre, and of course their music is not worth even playing on air. So, to give, to receive, or not to take, what to do now? Matthew.
Money and journalism.
Maybe they're trying the man...
where he worketh.
But is it wrong? Is it wrong to receive? If a musician comes to you as a presenter and tells you, "Hey man, just take this 20,000, just to play my song, just play my song." Is it really wrong?
Let's first go back to Adams. He said every presenter, right?
Yes.
Is it not a presenter?
Every presenter who does a show that is about showbiz takes money.
Is he a presenter?
Is he not
himself?
A presenter? Who,
as we speak, he's not.
Ah. Yeah. Why didn't he say this?
He told me he's jobless. No, he's not jobless. his employer's job is less. I mean, he just.
What do you mean his employer's job is less? What does that mean?
Yeah. So as we speak,
he's not working.
As a radio presenter, he's off air. So
this finger pointing, you spoiling this, you see, Eugene, maybe the thing to look at here is, as you said, the issue of journalism and money.
Yeah.
Because in the first place, we all agree that the basic principles of journalism have to be preserved if that field or if that profession is to serve the role it has to serve in society.
But hold on. Which is radio presenters called journalists actually. It's also first
radio presenters. Are they journalists? I don't know.
That's,
but we have
that's
radio
another story.
That's another story.
Interesting
another
me
day.
Here now.
Because
Journalism also involves
someone is doing it and they don't think it's wrong. Maybe, I don't know. It's not right, but also let's look at both sides.
Mm.
How does Adams come up with... That's a very serious accusation.
Accusation, yeah.
And he's saying every presenter...
Every
how?
Presenter we doing need, showbiz.
Yeah, because it's serious.
There are two sides. Either he also gave them money to do something for him,
mm.
all of them,
or
he has received money and he knows the circles of receiving this money.
No, I think whether he did it or not, it's a very serious accusation. And you don't say stuff like that unless you have information to back it up.
Mm.
You don't accuse people of taking money... Just I do promote. Not think that yeah. everyone is doing that.
Mm-hmm.
If they are doing that, then it's something very bad. But we also need to know
mm-hmm.
where he gets this information from. That's number one. Number two,
mm-hmm.
who is here to say that some music cannot be played on radio and some can be played? We also need to know where he gets this expertise. If we,
he's been in the industry, yeah,
since 94
as a DJ and a presenter, so he knows which music should be played.
That
and
doesn't
which
make
music
you an expert. That doesn't make you an expert. I think
20 years of experience doesn't make him an expert.
Oh yeah, that there's he's. I understand where he's coming from. If and I'm I really know it happens.
Yeah.
I know some people really do get money to publish things or to have things on radio.
Mm-hmm.
But I also think we need to be very careful with the kind of words we use when we are talking about people who are in this profession. Because, and we also need to know, we also need to be a bit calm when we are talking about saying this one's music is better than this one's music.
Mm-hmm.
Who is there to determine what is better than what? So maybe if a song is on radio and you don't like it, you promptly
think
someone
paid. It's
not your
position to say that.
Mm. No, you see, what I've been seeing, if you watch some of these TV stations, some on DSTV like E or any, when there is a documentary about a certain musician or a certain genre of music, you'd see someone giving an analysis and they would write there, you know, music journalist, you know, or music...
There's a difference between music
journalist and
expert.
So we have people who decide to take that line, you know, of analyzing, of knowing which is good, which is not good. They can be able to give you an opinion. And then it's up to you whether you'll accept or not accept it. I think we need also to encourage such kind of people who
no,
are able to give
Eugene.
Open-minded...
I didn't say what he did is wrong because it's actually happening. But I also
no, but
need,
you said it is wrong for someone to sit somewhere and just say this
I'm
music
saying
is wrong.
To say that good. Everyone, it's like standing there and you say all the women in Rwanda are this and this and this.
Mm.
What are the parameters? What did you use to come to that conclusion?
He said one, most of the ones that he's mentioned are copy-pasting music. If you go and listen to some music from another country and then you listen to that one, you
he has
hear...
had this argument for a very long time, by the way. I've heard it.
Mm,
and he has amassed quite a number of enemies because of it. And I think it's interesting. He's
consistent.
He brings up things that most people, other people don't bring up. Mm. And there is some truth to it.
Mm-hmm.
But what I think should be discouraged mm-hmm. is to say, all radio presenters are doing this and this. If you're going to do it and if you've decided you're going to be open about something, maybe it's best that you're completely open about it and you say so and so and so and so and this is the evidence.
But I guess I got Eugene right. Eugene, you said he gave you names of people, of presenters.
Names of shows. That's just like directly naming the presenters.
He gave
presenters.
Names of shows?
Yes. That.
How come
we
haven't heard that? You should... We need to hear it. Is there a reason why you're hiding it? You're the one misleading us.
Or you're part of those shows that are being named. Because
let's listen and see if we can be able to hear anything
okay.
like the shows. I wasn't able to cut specifically where he mentioned those shows, but let's listen to this.
All these presenters who are doing what is called showbiz, all of them.
All of them?
All of them.
Are taking the
all
viewers, the
them,
audiences
yes.
for a ride.
All of them, yes.
They're taking... this small amounts of money to
yes.
promote this.
Yep.
Do you have any proof?
Unless if you want it in numbers.
Tell me. We have the time.
There are so many.
Tell me. Just 10 or even 5.
5 what?
Yes. Number one?
Presenters.
Yes. That you feel are taking people for a ride.
I told you, including your own on.
That's not an answer.
No, it's
Eugene,
it's,
you're also taking us for a ride. You know something, and you
Eugene
know
deliberately no, cut out of the part.
No, maybe cut out your own and then continue to the rest.
He deliberately cut out of the part where they mentioned the shows, and I am skeptical whether his show is not part of them.
No, when he mentioned your own, he was specific. He said your own radio station here.
Yes, and then
now
after that?
He mentioned, he said Route 66. He mentioned Route 66 is a show that airs here on Contact FM. He also mentioned 10 Superstar is a radio show that airs on
Radio 10.
On Radio 10. He also mentioned some shows on Isango. The whole interview is available actually on YouTube. You can be able to watch and see all that DJ Adams or the shows that DJ Adams mentioned. So there's
Did you
no
ask
deliberate.
Him how he came to that conclusion,
but you heard he says he has concrete evidence and
we need to. You see, the thing is, it helps us debate these things the right way, because if you say, the reason why I'm saying that is because I keep on saying it's not right for someone to come up and say all these shows. So if he has evidence, and if you've decided you're going to be the one to be the watchdog. Then the best you can do is to actually come out with all the information. He came out all guns blazing, and then somewhere, I don't know what happened to the
police. Generalization is wrong, but then we cannot rule out the fact that there is some truth to what he's saying.
I cannot say that because all the shows he has mentioned, I do not want to discuss people when I don't know for a fact whether he has personal problems with them.
With them or not.
It's a very serious... In fact, it's just that we've pushed Eugene to repeat it, but even him, he shouldn't have. You don't want to say just because someone said and he has not showed you any evidence, you don't want to come up and start saying, this show is doing this.
What we could discuss or debate here is it wrong for a radio presenter to receive money from an artist in order to play their music? Is it really wrong? If I was a musician and I see Nash has a show that does showbiz and plays music, and I come to Nash and say, here is some 20,000 Rwandan francs.
Please play my music.
I think it's wrong. It's not fair because it makes you... It's like any other type of corruption.
That's blind.
If Eugene has no money,
his music won't be played. And as Nash said, maybe unless if you're saying radio presenters are not journalists. But if they are journalists, then it is wrong to the profession.
But I'm sure even if they're not journalists, they know when they're employed... The contract has something it says. You're working for a salary. Otherwise, they should be telling you, get your own money. as long as you're here on time and you have your show, we don't care how else you're going to get paid.
But we have radio presenters who believe that even some DJs actually have been dragged into this. That we have some DJs who are told, play my song in the clubs, push it for me, and here's some 20,000 or 10,000.
DJ is a different story altogether.
But still, we have those who say that I would still take the money. Why would I take the money? It is not like corruption. It is just like an incentive. It is just like a encouragement.
But
somehow
that money comes with the CD. Yeah?
Let's listen to what MC Tino said, because Tino also is a radio presenter
and
he was on
One-on-One
and also a musician at the same time. So let's listen to what he said concerning this particular issue.
Yes.
Has there been any artist who has ever come to you and said, Tino, take this 10,000 francs?
Very many.
Please promote
very
my song.
Many.
And what
very
has
many.
Been your reaction?
My reaction is like if you come to me like telling
speak
me
speak the truth and
I'm
shame
telling,
the devil.
Yeah, I'm my reaction is if you come with let's say 20,000 or 40.
Yes.
And you know your music is good.
Mm-hmm.
You know your music is good.
Mm-hmm.
It is not like you're not giving the money to take you to the next level.
Mm-hmm.
If the song is good, I'll play the song
and take the money.
I'll play the song and take the money.
You'll take the money
and
play the song.
And that money, most of the time, there's this word they use. You know,
Gitti.
Very good.
Yes.
This is what we call motivation in sales and marketing.
Uh-huh.
I did marketing.
Mm-hmm.
And there's what we call, paying for an advert. Like if you have money, I've had bigger names pay multi-million to play the songs, and the songs is right there in the billboard, but they know what they're selling. If your music is good, you don't need to spend a lot of money. But the people giving out money are these people who are not proud of what they do.
Okay.
If you're proud of what you do, never give out money.
There you have it. So...
So that means the money he takes and he plays the music. He knows very well the music is not good, but he plays it.
this is disturbing. I've heard him talk about amounts. So if the music is not good and I come up with 200,000.
No, but he says even elsewhere they are it's like paying for an advertisement.
Are you going to say that elsewhere because they are killing people are also going to do it?
You're trying to make me say that again. My wife is more beautiful than the gorilla. Can you compare yourself?
No. Guys, let's be realistic. You go to a barber shop. You get shaved. And there's this specific barber who shaves you. And when you leave, you give him a tip.
Eugene, tips.
Is it wrong to get a tip as Eugene, a presenter?
Eugene, tips and money given before the duty is even offered are very different.
You give a tip before, if you go to a restaurant and you give a tip before, you're
looking
like,
for the money.
You're like, I'm not harming anyone, but I think it's not right.
It's not right.
I don't
to
know
receive.
How radio stations work. I'm thinking they are music directors. The music, I've heard of a radio station here where you take music and it has someone it goes to and they listen to it and then they decide when and where they're going to play it. But if you're going to give Eugene when you meet him in the corridor, then you give Makeda, then you give who, there's a problem. And you're trying to create a void to give people space or opportunity to take, and it's a bribe. To be honest with you, it's a bribe. What happens to someone who doesn't have money?
Shauri yake.
Really?
But then you're kidding the entire industry, the entire music sector.
Do you realize that most of the time there are these people who don't have money, but they have
and
really
they are doing
great
very
music.
good music.
So then what do we do? What happens? We don't have a police. Who's going to police
Eugene,
what presenters will play? We don't
them.
Have them.
I'm
so,
going
so
to do the
happened?
Job of putting them out there in the open.
Eh?
Then everyone can know.
You want to join DJ Adams' bandwagon?
Yeah. At least I'm going to go and talk to him and he gives me his facts where he got them from. Maybe he didn't want to mention so many things. Mm-hmm. And then, because it's not fair. Mm. It's really not fair.
So you're specific that if it is about giving you so that you play the song, it is wrong. But if it is about me, I'm happy as a musician that you usually even play my song on your show and then I decide to just give you 20,000, that's okay.
If I bring my music here and it's played and somewhere, K-Club or I don't know where, and I meet the artist and I say, oh my God, I heard the music. It does for me. I don't think it should matter. Anyway, when I meet you and I give you 20,000, I think at least somewhere, somehow, someone will be like, it was a tip. Even if you're to go and report me to the bosses, I probably can win that case. But what does it mean to come with
20,000
a CD?
Yes.
And why do they always hide it? If you're really happy about it, why are you giving?
Why don't you take it from the counter of your reception at the
just leave it
station.
And say, please give this money to Eugene. Why? It's because you know at the back of your mind, you're not doing something right. And I'm actually very, I don't know if I'm shocked or impressed by MCT not admitting that he takes the money.
You see, you ask that what should be done. You see, issues with professionalism are matters of ethics.
Yeah.
I mean, no one is going to take you to prison because you're taking money to play someone's music.
Yes.
But then, is that the right way to approach your work as a presenter or as a journalist? So it's a matter of ethics, training, talking about these things like we're now talking about to them. And people should learn that, you see, you take 20,000 today, but you're spoiling your face, your reputation. People won't trust the music you're playing.
You think people care about that stuff when they're looking at money?
You see, it's very interesting what comes out, because also on the issue of reporters or journalists.
Mm.
We've had instances where a journalist goes to the field to cover a particular story and over there they're given some goodies in quotes.
GT?
Not just GT. Let's say a diary if you want to cover an event of Company X and they give you a diary of 2014 or 2015, or you go and they give you a bag or they give you a t-shirt. Do you know that in some countries where journalism is so developed, that is wrong to take it. And what they do is you're told whatever you receive from the field over there, it does not belong to you. You need to give it to the station,
exactly.
To the office,
yeah.
And then in December, during Christmas or something like that,
they distribute
the station them. Goes to distribute such kind of giveaways to the orphans or to the underprivileged.
Including the 40K?
Everything. Would you give it out? Would you? Do you think we have reporters who'd give them out? Because most of the time we've seen others even fighting for those things.
Eugene, I am very glad you're bringing this up. But you see, you're trying to compare situations that are completely different. I'll give you a very simple example. Mm-hmm. There are very many radio stations in this country that do not pay their staff.
Mm-hmm.
Recently,
do not pay on time?
Do not pay.
So what are they
do not pay. Wait. If no. The same way Nash even said we need to have proof every time we talk.
Yes, I'm now. I'm still talking.
Do you have your proof?
I'm still talking.
Do you have your proof?
First, put the proof here.
Yes, do you have the proof before you continue?
I am still talking.
No, before you continue, Mr.
I have the proof,
us,
sir.
I have the proof, sir. What's
okay.
your proof?
I have been doing a research.
Uh-huh.
And I think I came to contact FM as well.
Talking to a number of
journalists. And it has come to my attention. And I collected this out. I have recordings. I have written documents
mm-hmm.
about this.
Uh-huh.
There are very many radio stations in this country.
Mm-hmm.
Online media houses
mm-hmm.
that do not pay their journalists.
Mm-hmm.
People are there, but they are there and they are only benefiting from such giveaways. I mean, I go to cover an event, a Minrena event.
And they benefit from the clothes, the t-shirts.
They give me the 10,000, they give me the 5,000. So I keep running around on just that. So the issue we are talking about is not only on the journalists. It mm-hmm. comes again to the media houses. You see, I've been talking about this with a number of people. Why should someone just wake up in the morning and say, okay, let me go and open a media house and employ people? No one knows their capacity, no investment, no nothing. No one follows up to know what these people are going to do. So if we as media houses still have people who are not facilitated, then you're creating that kind of environment,
you know,
to push these people into that.
When you say that, it's like you're directly saying that Edmund Kajire and group are not doing their job. Because we have so many, I've heard about so many advocacy groups or institutions or bodies that are supposed to advocate for journalists.
We have
so many of them.
Ask them whether they know RMC, all the journalists practicing in this country.
We have RMC.
Mm-hmm.
We have the Association of Rwanda Journalists.
Exactly.
We have the Media High Council.
Exactly.
So if you're saying that these things are still continuing,
I want you to direct this question to one of them and ask them, do you have the exact number of practicing journalists in this country?
I'll direct it to you, because when you are doing your research, you need to do conclusive
exactly
research. Have you gone to them and asked them?
Telling you that because I have asked you that.
You have asked
them whether any of them knows the exact number of journalists practicing in this country.
And they don't
None
know.
Of them knows. They only know those who go to them. So,
Matthew, you guys are going to go round and round in circles and you won't come to a conclusion, because
take us to the conclusion.
A complex issue. I think
mm-hmm.
we keep on thinking about the journalists and the media houses,
mm-hmm.
but we don't think about the people who give them this money.
Mm-hmm.
How do they come to that? There has to be, maybe if we're talking about what the Kajiris are doing,
they're exploiting a weak point.
Yeah, that's why we need
who's
to
exploiting
those
a weak
people
point.
Are giving them the money. They're exploiting a weak
but
point.
But you see, the thing is, it's also not conclusive. They're exploiting a weak point. How? Because sometimes they give this money and their stories are not
even aired.
Yeah.
Mm.
So
no,
what
happens?
It's them who are the weak point, because they're giving out money and no one is doing anything. So maybe what needs to be done, maybe the question that should be put to the Kajiris is to discourage these people
who give out the money.
Number one. Number two. These people, the institutions or the businesses, I don't know what category to put them in or what name to give them, they should not deal with journalists individually. They should deal with media houses. There's an editor, there's a director, there's what... If you're going to follow up and make sure that your story is published because you want it to see it in a newspaper, you want to hear it on radio, you want to see it on TV, the best you can do is to follow up with the editor of...
of a given media house.
I think that is even wrong. If as an editor, I wouldn't even accept even a minute to take any pressure.
I am not from saying pressure. No, listen.
To follow up with me, did you publish our story or you didn't?
No.
It is our choice.
Eugene.
We will come or we will not.
You get it wrong. I'm saying.
So why are you saying they should deal with the media house?
I'm not getting it wrong.
This topic should have someone else coming to this crossfire.
This is how it's usually done. You send an invite. There's a workshop. Novotel. The worst you can do is to bring the invitation to a journalist and then you start following up a journalist. And I've seen it happen and it actually works. You bring the invitation, they sign for it, it gets to the media house. The event is on Tuesday. On Monday, if I call you as the editor and I say, just a reminder, we brought an invite there, unless you have another problem as an editor, you're not going to be angry and say this is pressure. Or in the morning, if I call you as the editor and say, from this NGO I was calling about the invite and to remind you that the event is today, Sibjo, how are you going to be angry? But if I come and say, this is a contact, so can I talk to Matthew Rahiji? Then you come, then I give you the invite, then I tell you we'll come and pick you and then we'll drop you and then there will be lunch, by the way, but we also refund you your transport if we don't, and that transport is 15,000. That's where the problem comes in. But if you are dealing with an editor, he's going to be like, we are sending Matthew for this story, and after that the editor is the one who's going to determine.
But you see, Nash, I think one thing for sure is that even that relationship happens between institutions and journalists is unethical. It's very ethical, because most of the times, if I am a PR in a certain institution, I have to be in good books with a couple of journalists in the right media houses. So I can still communicate with these people. But then I think the challenge is that these institutions sideline working with media houses because they do not want to engage in anything like maybe large settlement issues. I hear want a partnership with this radio station, maybe things of the sort. So instead of me trying to work in good lines with the media house, instead I try to bribe the journalist on the side, such that this journalist always thinks about my stories. You know,
the problem is sometimes, most times you lose out.
How much is a minute on air?
What I know for sure is that this is a complex issue, because at the end of the day, yes, you will say as a company, we come up with a policy and say none of our reporters has to ever receive any money from any institution when you go to cover a story. But you will not be there in the field
to monitor
that. That's number one. Number two, sometimes you'll find that a reporter goes to cover a story and they don't even know. It's not even in their mind that there will be this envelope. But you'll see them being called on the side and told, we have your transport here.
Have you not also had seen, because
I've seen it.
Seen reporters actually demand for say, that. Saying, demand we're not for living it. Without the money.
Exactly.
We've gotten to that level also. Of where, because they've gotten
actually,
used to it.
They're even those ones called.
They demand for it.
Even those ones called free lunch. They come for workshops at around 11:30 there. So they have lunch.
So the big question here is, just the same way we've asked about the presenters receiving this money to play a song, is it wrong for a journalist to accept or even to receive that brown envelope from an institution you went to cover? Is it wrong?
It's most definitely wrong. It's not right. That is the truth.
Which is a very hard truth.
Wait. I'm doing what I do best here, and that is being the devil's advocate. What if I take the money, but I still be professional in my reporting? What's wrong with that? If I take the 10,000 and I still write my story objectively.
It's very difficult for you to be objective when you took someone's money. Let's be realistic. There's a difference between Matthew, who has given you money, and me, who hasn't, and we both have stories. That you're not going to treat them the same. Even if you want to convince yourself that you're being fair, you remember, the man gave me 40K. It's still here. You're typing your story, or your I keep on saying typing because I'm a print journalist.
Yes.
So I don't mean that that happens with print journalists. I have to put a disclaimer, but yes. I always refer to it because that's what
I do, or what
I've done before.
Mm-hmm.
So I think to be on the safe side,
yes.
please don't take the money. I know it's really hard. Money is sweet. When you look at it, you just find you, your heart is telling you don't take it, but your hand is reaching out for the money.
Difficult. For me, in my opinion, I would do what most Kenyan voters have proven to be doing. They would, you'd see those
take
people,
the sugar and
those people who come for elections during election period.
Campaigns.
Yes, yes. The ones with the money bags, they come with the money and they pour it everywhere. They advise each other and say, just take the money. Cooler, eat it. But know where to vote.
But it's different.
So it's the same situation. If the institution is insisting on giving you this transport, go ahead.
But you don't get
take it.
Take it. You really haven't
still,
seen an embarrassing
But still do your
situation.
Story. The way you're supposed
you
to
haven't
do
seen
it.
An embarrassing situation where people have gone for stories.
Yes.
They've been given that money. Mm. They come. They just realize, there's no story here, Kabisa. They don't publish it, and the person comes. Where's Eugene? I gave him my money. We gave him. He asked even why you signed.
Uh-huh.
We gave him 50,000. Why we haven't seen the
we
story?
Haven't
he has
seen
been
the
saying
story.
Tuesday.
I would ask them mm-hmm. what was that 50,000 for.
But you see,
what was it for? Was it for them to cover the story, or was it for the facilitation?
You know what they usually call it? Uh-huh. They call it facilitation.
Of course.
Money.
So you facilitated my reporter. So the reporter has no wrong.
Actually, I can assure you, there's no editor in this world who will sit there and say, "It's okay. Why were you giving him the money? You facilitated him." So unless
he also ate some of the money,
I don't know. But there's no one who's going to be. There's no media. Media house
yes.
that is going to be very excited about you taking money from sources anywhere, unless you want to tell me something that I don't know. Tell me where they take it, and it's a lot actually out here.
You see, what I understand is the fact that we are dealing with a complex issue, because at the end of the day, you have sometimes also a media house that is not fully equipped in terms of even transportation or anything like that. And you have a reporter who really wants to go there. And there's this institution that wants you to cover their story, and they're even willing to bring their own car to come and pick you.
Yeah, it happens
and they will
all
even
the time.
Tell you, we will offer transportation back to work.
Mm-hmm.
Is that wrong?
There's what I'm really trying to concentrate on is not someone coming to pick me from here and then they bring me back.
Mm-hmm.
I'm trying to concentrate on someone bringing their music or bringing their story, and they give someone 50,000 and say, do what you have to do. Those are two different things.
Oh, you know what to do.
And then after they have eaten the money and I've enjoyed, I look at the story, I'm like,
Eugene,
there's nothing here.
Eugene.
Yes.
We should, as you said, we all agree this is a very complex issue,
mm-hmm.
which not only is looking at the journalists themselves or the presenters themselves,
mm-hmm.
but also has a lot to do with the quality of the media houses in this country.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. We like I had already said, there's still a lot of market dynamics playing around, even in the media sector. You have these stations, or you have these media houses. As you said, they are not well facilitated. They don't have the finances, you know. So if this journalist, Eugene, you'll agree with me, if you're going to go to cover this story and you know this person can give you 50,000 and your salary is already on the 15th of another month, and the previous month you haven't had it, I will not blame this journalist who does that. It's very unethical. Like I said, it's not right. But then the forces in this kind of on this industry, the media industry, are still too many.
But
you know?
Cannot. I don't agree with you. You, I know it's really
yes,
difficult.
Yes,
I know you
don't agree with me. I understand.
And I know it's really difficult, survival and everything. But maybe instead of saying you won't blame someone, you know it's wrong, but you won't blame them because they have not been paid. It's 15th, and then they have things. I think if you're not going to do something right, then don't do it.
Be realistic.
So should people
Nash, be realistic?
No, like seriously.
He has just said
I want you to
clearly.
Be realistic.
Be realistic as well. He has said it. It's 15th of the month. I haven't received my salary. So, I have this institution that is calling us to do a story. I know they usually give the money. And they're telling me I have to write the story in a good way. Will I not refuse?
Eugene.
Honestly. And will I be wrong if I take the money?
Nash, have you ever taken GT?
Me? Mm. I have.
Okay. Of course.
Actually, it used to be quite sweet. I don't want to lie to you. But then you reach a point, and I think, I don't know if it's growth.
You reach a point when you're growing.
You reach a point, exactly. And you realize that it's... one thing I can never do is start standing on a line and I'm going to sign for money. What used to happen at that time, and it's a long time ago, by the way, really a long time ago, I'm talking about maybe 2002.
So for you, it was a matter of you felt embarrassed. You can't stand on that
I just
line.
Felt it was wrong. And I've seen it. I've seen it even with younger people now.
Was it because you climbed the ladder? You received more money.
I think it's the way it used to be done. And to be honest with you, we're also mixing issues here. They would tell you, there are institutions that would tell you, they wouldn't tell you anything. You just get in the morning, you go for the story, you're done, you're leaving. They just give you like 5,000 francs for transport. Facilitation. That 5,000 used not to affect the way you're going to write the story because it is to actually be called transport.
Yes.
But the what we're talking about now is someone giving you 40,000 and tells you this is what you have to do. You know, what did you call it? You know what to do.
Yeah, you know what to do.
So the reason why it stopped... Matthew, don't look at me like that. I'm
trying to follow the story.
Yeah, like you said, the whole thing, I didn't even understand. At first, I used to look at it and I'm like, maybe this is what is done everywhere because it was actually like everywhere you go, people would do it. Then, first of all, I stopped. I couldn't even have lunch. People would sit. Then journalists started, and I know a really major media house here where it is embarrassing. Unfortunately, I can't say it, but
is that why you're moving away from the microphone?
Just, everyone knows. They tell you we are not showing up unless you've already put the money there. It's so embarrassing because they are in a position where they should be more embarrassed than all of us to ask for that kind of money. And I know Matthew knows them. I'm not going to say on air.
All right.
And it's a lot of money for them. If let's say they're giving you facilitation of 5,000.
For them, they'll give them.
They'll give them like 60,000.
What?
And people have openly talked about it these days. We have to facilitate this.
But you just said here that you would love now to join the DJ Adams.
But I haven't joined. I said I would love to.
Show the signs by mentioning. Come on. Are they? let me read some comments.
When I join him officially next weekend, I'll come with an answer. I'll tell you. Remind me.
Please do read the comments
let me read some of the comments that are coming through right here. We have one here that was coming on the question that we had asked there, whether it is right for a radio presenter to receive any money to be able to play a song from any artist. Is it wrong if they received any money? I have Credo East on Twitter who says, totally wrong. How will we hear other artists' music? There are good underground artists who don't have that money yet. Yeah, so kindly add the hashtag CrossfireCFM. It helps me to be able to track your messages quite easily. I have another one from Nyasha David who says here, technically it isn't wrong. This is on the issue of the reporters or presenters, I mean reporters receiving the brown envelope.
So what does it mean technically?
It says technically it isn't wrong.
I mean, if you were to, Nyasha, how long the brown envelope has been going.
I've noticed every time someone wants to confuse me. Let me tell you technically.
Let me finish his comment. He says, technically, it isn't wrong. As long as they are all looking at one goal, getting money out of each other. You see? So the reporter wants the money from this person. And also, the person giving the money wants the story to go.
Can you reply to him? Because I know him. He's a singer. Have you done it?
to reply to who? No, this one is on the issue of the reporters. Now, I have another one here from Rutarindwa on Twitter, which says, if we go by the code of ethics, this is for the reporters who receive the brown envelope, which we rarely go by, it's not acceptable. Although, on what terms you accept it matters too. So there are usually terms and conditions.
So
if it's okay, you know, it depends on the terms that you are accepting. And I think I kind of agree with him on that issue of the terms. It depends, because we have stories that are considered as infomercial stories.
Mm.
Infomercial stories where you find a company comes and says, we are ready to pay for the reporter to come with us, move with us, to cover this story in this direction.
We are ready. Who are they telling? Or your editor?
Anybody. They can tell me as a reporter, and then me, I go and tell my institution, because probably we have a personal relationship.
You tell them about the money.
We have a personal relationship. Probably have a personal relationship with company X. You know, they know me, I'm a relative, or we live close by, and they tell me they have a story about, you know, something that they're doing.
Have you ever taken money from someone?
Me?
Yeah.
Definitely.
Again, it depends on the terms. You get?
But I know why you're...
Do you know what I mean?
Both
by
of
the,
you.
The, by
and,
the,
oh, I agree.
Yes.
It's, we are looking at it as human beings and also as professionals on the other side. It's a complex issue because as human beings, let's accept, it's very difficult for someone to put 50,000 francs in front of
when your wallet has 1,000, especially.
In Rwanda, they say, Nawangi jana murini. So even if you have 20,000 and someone puts 50,000,
yes,
it's very difficult for you to just
to say no.
You're going to give it some thought. You may say, ah, no, I don't do that. It's okay, bring your story. But when he walks out, I can assure you, you're saying, but maybe I should.
I wish I should have taken it.
That is the human side of the story. The professional one, it conflicts with the human side, and usually the human side always wins.
Mm.
But it's wrong.
It's wrong. Mm. I have Mwasa there on Twitter who says, the so-called brown envelope comes in different forms, and it's what kept journalism everywhere. That's what he says. It's not good, but it's normal.
I mean,
and then he comes back and says, without it, there are so many things that would never be known. People or institutions pay to undermine others. Then we know. So, that's more.
That's
there.
The reality of it.
It's wrong, but it's normal.
If you were to track how long this thing has been going on.
No, it happens. I've seen it even in Uganda.
No,
this complaint has been going on for a very long time.
The brown envelope started a long time ago. He comes back to address
specifically Nash, who says it is wrong and it's evil. Mwasa says, so whoever stands there and pretends that it's evil isn't being truthful, hasn't been a serious journalist, and taking listeners for a ride. So when you stand there and say...
No, but he didn't get
it,
me right.
Yeah.
And maybe, Matthew, for once you can be on my side. I said it's wrong.
Yeah.
But I said it's a conflict between the human side and the professional side.
Mm-hmm.
And it's really difficult to say no to money. Remember that's what I said.
Mm-hmm.
I still insist. Mm-hmm. Even if you give in and take the money,
yes, it's still wrong.
It's human, but it's wrong.
It doesn't
make it right.
Which almost every reporter has taken
at some point experienced. You know? Yeah.
Okay.
Money is the devil itself.
All right, we take a very short break right now. Of course, remember, keep those comments coming through. All you need to do is add the hashtag CrossfireCFM so that it's easy for us to track them right here. And of course, we'll be able to read them. And the question we had asked you over there, is it wrong for a reporter or a journalist to accept or receive the brown envelope from an institution he went to cover the story? Is it wrong? And if it is, why? And if it is not also wrong, why do you think so? So get those comments coming through. 897 is the number to call. We'll be opening our lines so that if you're able to call us, we'll be able to receive you. And also on our SMS lines, the numbers are 5000. All you need to do is write the word contact, leave a space, write your message, and send it to the numbers 5000. We'll return shortly. All right, welcome back to Crossfire. You're listening to 89.7 Contact FM. Remember, the show comes your way each and every Sunday from 2 p.m. And of course, we get to discuss and argue out some of our own opinions on certain issues that are happening around us here in Rwanda and the rest of the world. We've just been talking about the issue of the brown envelope. We've also had some of our views concerning that. We've also read some of your comments, which we encourage you to keep sending to us. We'll be able to read them in the course of the program. So keep that conversation going on Twitter. The hashtag is CrossfireCFM. Now, last week we had an issue whereby there was a woman who was arrested with cocaine worth 45 million Rwandan francs. And of course, this definitely was not a good day for this woman and any of his or of her associates. And the question that this issue brings is the issue of the level of punitive measures that we have that are dealing with those who are caught and even found guilty of, you know, drug trafficking. We also have a story in the region where President Uhuru Kenyatta observed or witnessed the blowing up or sinking of a ship that had cocaine worth billions of Kenya shillings. And so we're asking ourselves the issue of drug trafficking, whether the punishment that is there for the offenders or those who are found guilty dealing with them, are the punishment lenient? What is being done today? Is it enough to stop this? And that is the next topic that we're talking about right now in the next close to 30 minutes or so. So starting us off, we have the Minister of Justice, who we talked to right here in our news. And therefore, he had a few comments to say concerning the issue of the punitive measures. And he definitely agrees that there needs to be a debate around how much or how hard or how tough are our punishments for those who are found guilty with this offense. Let's listen in to what the minister had to say.
This is a multi-million dollar franc thing. Sometimes someone is willing to pay 5 million francs, fine. He is already making 50 million. So that is also a possibility. So we want to have an informed conversation on these things, and we as a country come up with a regime that we think is properly deterrent.
There you go. So that conversation that the minister says there, that is Minister Businje says there, is what we're going to have right now. Are our punitive measures tough enough to be able to make those who intend or those who are even practicing this in secrecy feel scared and say, no, I don't want to continue this? Because Article 594 of the Penal Code states that any person who unlawfully makes or transforms or imports or even sells narcotic drugs and other substances within the country shall be liable to a term of imprisonment of 3 to 5 years and or a fine of 500,000 Rwandan francs to 5 million or both. And here you have someone who you have caught with drugs worth 45 million.
Drugs which are only under her clothes.
So yes,
that means 45 just million. A small quantity.
Yes,
so she was probably testing the waters.
Exactly. So you, or maybe just by speculation, maybe we have he or she, in this case, maybe was already doing this business for some time, and they've already made this 45 and more. And there you are. You want to charge them and ask them to pay the highest, around 5 million Rwandan francs. Is this anything for them? Is this enough? This is the discussion that we want to have right here, right now. So looking at this issue that we are having on the table right now, Matthew, your experience, not of taking drugs, because you don't, I don't have any information to that direction. But from your experience of covering stories or listening or reading some stories on issues of drug trafficking, do you also feel that there is need to maybe make these punishments even harder than what we have today?
I am not trying to put anyone onto the cross, but the issue is the punishments are even kind of embarrassing.
Mm-hmm.
Because the drug trafficking, should I call it industry as well? It's a very, very wealthy one. There's a lot of money running around in the drug trafficking business. Mm. So if you're going to tell someone, because last time I was looking at some story, was it in the New Times or was it in Kigali? I don't remember very well. someone was trying to follow up the chain of these guys who are selling cannabis here. So even just one stick of weed, as they call it, costs almost 5,000.
It's expensive,
you know. So if you're going to charge this person who has been doing this business a fine between 500,000 and 5 million, that's almost a joke to them. Or if you're going to take them to prison and they know I'll be there for between 3 to 5 years. No, is it between 1 to 3 years? Three to five years.
Yes.
And this person knows I can still follow up on my chain of business in those couple of years while I'm in prison. And by the time I come back, the business shouldn't have died anyway. So I don't think they are enough. And I think that is why we are even seeing a lot of drug abuse happening in this country. Very many young people these days are engaging in this line of business. Like you said, I should say things when I have proof.
Yes. Do you have any?
Yesterday I was in the crowning event of Gumaguma, the last show.
Yes.
as they were crowning the PGG SS for season 4, and it's absurd that I'm saying this.
Mm.
I saw a clique of young people, a few of them white, and they were smoking.
What were they smoking?
Inside the ground.
Mm.
You can smell you can smell cannabis from afar.
Mm.
They had rolls,
mm-hmm.
you know? Yes. So it was just absurd seeing that.
Mm.
I told the photojournalist I was with, I told him to take a few photos.
Mm-hmm.
He took photos. I have them on my camera.
Mm-hmm.
So it's just absurd that it seems it's not a very scary thing to deal with. People don't feel like they are very scared to do some of these things, playing around with these drugs around the community. But the impact
mm-hmm.
that this has are way far much grave. Because if you're going to have young people who can easily access these drugs, they do not know what life is about. They haven't seen anything. So it is easy for them to get all these drugs around, alcohol, cannabis, anything, mention it. And what are you going to have? It's a society of people who know nothing else apart from drug use and drug mm-hmm. abuse. So I am 100% on your side this time around.
Mm-hmm.
We need to change everything. We need to review the kinds of punishments we are putting up for these people.
If we are to review, my dear Nash, you know, last time we asked you if you were the Minister of Transport, you even scared us, and we were like, just remain to be who you are. So if we were to have...
Raise our hopes.
Yes. What would you be thinking of if we were to make the punitive measures tougher? Let's talk of the jail terms. Let's talk of the fines. What would you be looking at?
Now I even feel like a minister. It's complicated because, truth be told,
yes,
this is a juicy business.
Mm-hmm.
The higher the risk,
very lucrative.
The higher the money,
mm.
the higher the risk, or the higher the risk, the better the money.
Mm.
It's even anywhere in the world, it's difficult for someone to start dealing in selling drugs and they ever stop.
Mm.
The same way it is difficult. There's drug addiction, but I think there's also drug selling addiction. So, what do we do? How does it get here? That's the number one thing.
Mm.
This woman was arrested coming from Burundi, right?
Mm-hmm.
I don't have concrete information, but I'm told most of these serious drugs come from Burundi, I think because of the connection on Lake Tanganyika. Matthew, I'm waiting for you to say something. And anyway, we need... The most important thing, I think, first of all, is to find out how they get here. But I'm not hearing anything.
Can you? I can hear you. Don't worry. Everything is okay. Me, I can hear you.
I couldn't hear you.
Yeah.
I saw you.
I was picking some phone calls offline just to filter and see if there are hours or some people were calling to ask for a song. Yeah. So I'm getting you quite clearly. But what I want us to also think of is compare with what is happening elsewhere in terms of the punitive measures that are being taken on people who are found guilty of this kind of a crime. In Uganda, I mean, in China, just a few weeks ago, we had a case where there are some Ugandans who were executed.
Killed?
Yes, in China. Executed because they were found guilty and they were convicted for drug trafficking.
It's a bit extreme.
So when we're asking ourselves these questions, again, the question that I would like to throw out there is the case or the issue too serious here to warrant even an increase in increment of the level of punitive measures? Because sometimes some people say we make the rules or the punishments tougher basing on the level of the cases that we're receiving.
Eugene.
I think it's, we can't wait. It's like the stuff we've been talking about for the last 1.5 months, waiting
for matters to get out of hand
before something can be done.
Mm.
The fact that someone can actually dare to use our airport to move drugs is not a very good sign. I think what has to be done has to be done. I don't care if it's one case a year, if it's 50 cases, if there's a way of, what is the phrase? Nipping it in the bud?
So you are in an English class, huh?
that's the best way to do it. If you're going to, I mean, I think most of the things here work because we are, this country is serious when it comes to the law.
Uh-huh.
When they say that this law is saying this and this, they take it seriously. There's nothing like lenience.
Mm.
In China, if they don't execute you, it's life in jail. If not life in jail, it's something equivalent to life in jail.
Mm.
If someone gives you 120 years, isn't that life in jail, really?
Definitely.
Yeah. So right now, whoever is taking drugs to China or moving drugs within China, they probably have a death wish. That's what I would call it. It's scary. It's very, I can assure you right now, even these Ugandan students, most of the suspects have always been students. Even if they are doing it, it's something that you have to think about for a very long time, and it's not a joke.
And write,
it's a bit less risky because people are still
kind of
they are not there. But this is the time. This is the time to put a stop to it. Someone needs to find out how these drugs are getting
here.
Between the 500,000 to 5 million, if we were to increase the fine, what would you suggest? Should we look at the ratio? Should we compare it with the amounts that that haul of drugs that you've been caught with is worth, so that either multiply by 100,
no,
for example,
if you're caught with drugs, even if it's 1 ounce or whatever it is, that how they measure it.
Mm.
I'm saying this as myself, as the proposed
Minister of Internal
Security, because for me, I think it's a security problem, that one also.
Definitely, most definitely.
So, to be honest with you, I cannot go less below 15 years.
15 years jail.
Yeah, why?
Mm-hmm.
Because whether it's 1 kilo, whether it's half a kilogram, it could be the beginning of someone's end.
Mm-hmm.
You know what they say about these hard drugs, heroin, cocaine?
Mm-hmm.
The anyone who has used them tells you the best way to avoid drugs is not to start.
Exactly.
The moment you begin, going back is a problem.
Mm.
So that person you're saying, he should go to jail for 3 years because he had half a kilogram, it was very little, could be, that half kilogram could be the one that could have
sent another 50 people.
That's number one. Number two, if he spends 3 years and he started with half a kilogram, when he comes out and he has seen jail and he knows it takes that long,
so whether he's whether hardened. Whether no matter the amounts, you for you 15 years is your minimum.
Yes, you have to give put something that is going to make people think twice
and
before they take such a risk.
And
you think about I am, let's say, 30 years old.
Yes.
I think about being in jail for 15 years. Maybe I haven't had a child.
Mm.
I have aspirations.
Mm.
The things we actually do take for granted. It's, we are walking around here, it's nothing. But if you see the inside of jail and you it occurs to you that you're going to be there for 15 years,
mm.
if someone who knows you or had interest in your business comes to see you, I can guarantee you're going to tell them not to dare.
Mm. No, you see, Eugene, like I had earlier on said, and I think Nash reinforced that. This is a very lucrative business. Someone invests maybe, let's say...
It's juicy, you know, that is the
it's,
word.
It's, yeah, very juicy. It's the other kind of picture they always draw in the Bible of the promised land, flowing with milk and honey, you know? So if you're going to take someone in prison for 3 years, Eugene, I doubt whether someone will come out and they have forgotten or they have thought twice about not going back to the same business.
Mm.
Because, I mean, in 3 years, I think I'm quite sure even the fruits of that business haven't dried away. They are still even enjoying some of the profits from the same business. So when this person comes out, most definitely, they will think about going back to the same line of work they were in.
Mm.
But 15 years, I think I'll send them in for at least 20.
20 years.
I wanted to say 20, but based on the last portfolio that Eugene gave me and my punitive measures, I just decided to go down by 5. Because, Eugene, I think when it comes to drugs, the way, only way people can understand it is if they have dealt with someone
who has been abusing drugs.
Mm. And you have no way of helping them. Look at us.
Mm.
How many rehabilitation centers do we have that can deal with such serious drugs? If someone was to overdose on those drugs, how many hospitals here can actually handle that?
Exactly.
So unless someone has really gotten in close contact with what drugs are capable of, it doesn't even have to be a relative. It has to be someone you know and you've seen and you can see what it can do.
Mm.
In fact, I'm beginning to agree with the Chinese.
Mm.
And the Chinese are having a problem because they've gone to that extreme. I don't think they would have wanted to kill anyone. They've gone to that extreme because
of the level of
the level and the speed at which
that it brings.
Yeah.
Mm. Let's cross the border. Let me take you to Mombasa, but no, we're not going there for a party or Mombasa Raha, but we're going there because something happened there on Friday where President Uhuru Kenyatta oversaw the sinking of a ship that was captured carrying heroin in Lamu. And this capturing or this arresting of this ship, if I may say, was done in July 2014. Now, on Friday, that is when it was being blown off, you know, destroyed.
Mm.
Some quarters have called this a PR move, a PR act, because Uhuru was saying this is a sign or a message to anybody out there, those who are using the Mombasa port as a way to bring in the drugs and to take it out, that, hey, it's no longer business as usual. I will destroy them. I will blow them out. But let's look at the timing. July 2014, and we're now in end of August. I don't know if you're the right people I should ask this question. But what do you read out of this? Because those who are saying, you know, sometimes we've had some corruption happening where you'd find, there was even an expose on one of the TV stations about these issues of drugs that are caught, and then some people inside, the insiders, take the drugs out of the boxes and replace them with some other stuff, and the business goes on, and then they say we have gone to destroy, but they destroy
Kaunga
and other boxes.
I think, I mean, it's weird because today we've used the word complex so many times.
Mm.
But if indeed there were drugs, whether it's a PR move or not, for me, I think it's something very commendable. I don't know what people want. Do they want him to sink the suspects, the people who had the drugs, and then they will be like, yeah,
set
now
them
we,
ablaze,
we're
and then you're like,
no,
ah,
I
now
think
he did.
Next time he should be like, we mean business, so next time it's your drugs and you on the ship, and you're going
we
to
set you ablaze,
and then they will understand. Everything has a beginning,
Eugene.
It's we have lost so much faith in our leaders in Africa, Paka, even when they mean good, we are suspicious,
we're still suspecting.
So, this is what we have to do. If people actually feel that has happened before where it has been a hoax, then they should ask next time. Actually, do you know the first thing that came to my mind when I heard that?
Mm.
I said maybe someone knows the exact spot and they're going to go and fish those drugs out.
Now there was a funny picture. There was a funny picture that is doing rounds after the sinking of this ship in the sea.
Mm.
There's a picture of some young boys who, not actually young boys, young men who went to swim in that area. And they're out of the water and their eyes are red and they're like, wow. Yeah, but that's the funny side. But it's, on a serious note, does it leave some doubts? Because, yes, some of you say it's a good act, it's a good move, whether PR or not PR. But from the journalistic aspect or the inquisitive part of journalism, July 2014 and you're sinking it in August, end of August, and there are no pictures or proof of showing these are the drugs themselves that we are going to sink or to blow up today. How much of confidence does that build? And whether it sends a message or not, how do we gauge that?
I think, personally, I think if we need accountability...
Don't worry, I'd said I'm not sure if you're the right people should ask this question.
No, it
should be Uhuru Kenyatta himself.
If there's any doubt, if we need any type of accountability, we all know very well that Mombasa, that's not the first time we're going to have a case with drugs.
Mm.
Maybe if it's a PR move that didn't go down well with some people, next time, people need to ask, they need to have accountability. What's in there? Are we sure that these are drugs?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we cannot sit here and start condemning a man who thinks he did the right thing. Maybe what we need to deal with in future is to make sure that we have the facts together. Mm-hmm. We are sure when we leave that place, we are sure that what is being said is actually what is being done.
Mm-hmm.
We also need to know. Before that, along the way, the tons of cocaine or heroin that were confiscated, or I don't know are they the ones that put when the months are put together? Is that the right amount of cocaine we have, or maybe we have less by
less
maybe
every,
one ton?
Yeah.
So there has to be, if people want answers, I don't know how it's done in Kenya. Maybe if he really was doing it for good reasons and PR reasons, then he needs the PR machine to work on something.
Such things to make people
sit back and say, Kabisa, this man has worked. But I've noticed that if it's PR, whoever is behind it, the last 1 week he has done quite well.
Eugene. Like Nash said, I think we as the African people, we've lost a lot in terms of trust for our leaders. You know, whenever someone does something, you're suspicious. You're like, that one, he can't do it in good faith. He has to have something behind it. But then, even as we ban, we get the drugs, we ban them, or maybe we punish the people we catch red-handed with these drugs. I think the thing should be that even the punishments should go into the entire chain of moving these drugs, not just the final man you find with the drug, not just this seller you find with the drug, but the entire chain. We have security officers inside there, we have government officials in there, so it should be a great move, a great exodus for the African.
Yeah, where that 1 kilo came from,
exactly.
There could be another 400.
So even the person who facilitated this person to go through Bujumbura Airport before they come to Kigali International Airport, you need to follow that whole chain and punish all of them equally. Because otherwise, you're just wasting people's time. You're taking out one person out of a million people and you're doing nothing absolutely. You know? So unless we touch the source and you keep like, I saw this kid, he was having 5 kgs of ese cannabis and you have taken the kid.
Let me first ask you, if you found taking drugs, are you also thrown in?
What do you mean? If you found...
If I'm found taking cocaine.
It's the same, like if you ask me if you're found smoking weed where it is illegal, you'd definitely be also taken in.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I know these drugs are actually beginning to make things like weed look less like a lesser evil.
So let's get back home and
back home?
have the final word on this issue back here. You know, I said I'm taking you to Mombasa, and you guys want to stay there. I don't know for what reasons. You want to drink that water in that?
I think I should go swimming as well.
Actually, now that you mention it, if we are going to look for, we need accountability.
Yes.
We need cameras down there to see if there are no Kenyans there waiting
underground.
When it's coming down,
yeah, you yeah. get the water, and then you go, you dry the cocaine out.
Drug dealers and people interested in drugs.
Yeah. So looking at this issue, I mean, even if the ministry would want to do something about the law itself or the penal code on issues of the punishments for the offenders, those who are found guilty, who would they be talking to? Who would be the right people for them to talk to? To get this advice, would it be Parliament? And if it is Parliament, what kind of talk would we be expecting from there? In order to let's push the conversation forward as we get into the new week, as the minister said, there needs to be discussion on this issue. So looking forward, who would it be? The public? Would we see an opinion question out there for people to say we want this to be done? Or we don't want this to happen, or change this, or change that, or leave it the way it is. In your opinion, Nash, what do you think, or what do you think this conversation
everyone,
should be like?
Mm. Everyone is. I mean, if I find out that, for example, if we go back to me being the minister,
mm-hmm.
if I find
who would
out
you
that,
be talking to? Who would
if
you
I
be
found out
for?
Matthew,
yeah.
for example,
mm.
had drugs and you knew about them,
mm.
and you didn't say anything, you definitely would get at least your 6 months down there. In jail too, because you have information. You are betting the this whole drug trafficking thing. The first thing, and I've noticed the Rwandan police really insists on it, and it has been working.
Mm.
Is information.
Mm.
The community policing.
You need you see drugs. You have to put in your head that this is actually my business.
That's information being given out to everyone.
Yeah,
but what about on the issue of changing the punishments, the level of punishments?
But you see, Eugene,
Eugene knew exactly
mm.
was the best person to ask that answer, mm. that question, because mm. everything
mm.
begins and
ends,
and somehow ends with him. That's his territory.
Yeah.
Eugene, I think we have processes of revising laws.
Mm. Mm.
As the Ministry of Justice, which mm. is charged with this kind of work, I mean, they should forward their request to the Parliament about change of this particular article
mm.
and change
mm.
of these punishments.
Mm.
And then the Parliament has channels through which it has to get public opinion on these things.
Mm.
The Parliament should be listening into this show and hearing what we are saying. We are saying we want 15, 20 years. So they should be listening to the entire community and gathering all this information about these things. But then, like you had asked earlier, I think the issue of drug abuse in this country is already getting escalating to some levels where we need to take very serious precautions. And
very fast.
You know?
Mm.
Because judging from the campaigns that this country has been undertaking to fight drug abuse, in especially underage children, judging from just that, it shows that it's already taking political attention. It's already capturing the attention of the community. So that means it's already high. When you walk through the streets of Nyamirambo, you see kids trying, sniffing, is it, what do they call it? Is it coal?
Glue.
Yeah, sniffing coal. So it's a drug mindset. You know, people are already getting into that kind of culture.
At some point, that one is not going to work, and they learn something.
Yeah, it's cool. It's cool. It's cool using drugs. It's nice. So it's a culture already kind of being propagated within the community. The community is already getting
what's the body synonymous to NACADA here in Rwanda? You know, NACADA, we have a body that is charged with the issue of
narcotics.
Dealing with the consumption, the fight against consumption of drugs. Here in Rwanda, what's the body? I should have asked you.
I think that duty is still with the national police.
The national police.
Yes,
I think there's need for more campaign on this issue, and probably
with emphasis on punishment.
Punishing everybody within the entire chain, not just the person you found with 5 kilograms
even
of cannabis.
Knew about you.
Exactly, punishing the whole chain. If there's a police officer who saw this and he was bribed, maybe 5,000. I'm just saying that $5,000, not francs.
All right.
So you know that whole chain.
Yeah. So I'll take it as our last remark, and also our last plea on the issue of the use and trafficking of drugs. This is coming from us here, that those in charge need to now act, and act really fast. And according to Nash, our shadow minister of justice, and
contact FM. People may start sending me. You know, in Africa,
messages.
They don't send you congratulations messages. They send you messages of the first salary.
They want something in it.
Long lost relatives may start
you
showing
see,
up.
Yes. Our son, so has this problem.
There you go. So we need more in terms of this communication, awareness, and also emphasis on the punishment, so that at least it can also discourage people from even thinking about getting in there, much as we also inform them on the needs of not participating in drug trafficking and abusing of drugs. There's need for more and more discussion on these issues and more. Yes, so we have to close the show at this particular point. Thank you so much, Nash. Thank you so much, Matthew, for being on our
Thank you
crossfire.
For having us, Eugene.
Yeah.
Have a lovely week.
And you too. I see Matthew doesn't want me to have a lovely week, so he took his time to prepare.
You see, I was thinking about what is still happening in West Africa.
You want to bring Ebola back?
No. Yesterday, and the previous, the reports are already showing Senegal is also getting attacked.
Yeah,
so it's a very sad story, and the world, Rwanda inclusive, whoever has anything to do with that, we need to see people at least now taking it to another level. Whatever they've been doing, I think, is not enough yet. We need to see more being done. Because I am educating my people around me, because that is all I can be able to do.
I think next week we'll have some discussion a bit about this, because how can one doctor survive and then thousands just die?
Animal farm.
It's
exactly. It's animal farm.
So we'll end at that particular
Thank
point.
You,
See you. Bye-bye. Have a good week. I'm Eugene Anangwe. Goodbye, and stay in touch.